Okay, I think that's all set. Hello! This is a video I'm recording to demonstrate... Turn down my volume a bit. To demonstrate the routing for this game, to speedrun it, basically. I've had a few people ask me because they were curious, and now a few people have asked me because they actually want a resource for this, and I sort of did a stream where I showed some stuff off, but I didn't really like the stream. There was a lot of unnecessary stuff, and I talked about some other things, and I just decided I'd re-record it. So, yeah, I'll basically just be... This won't really be a real run. It'll be more of a slowly-ish going through my route for the speedrun and explaining any glitches or routing choices. And if anybody can find a way to improve this, that would be really cool. This will be an any percent run, so I will... What I'll be getting is all of the treasures. I have not found a way to skip the treasures, so I'll have to get all of them. But I will not be getting anything... And I'll be getting actually every item except the flashlight. Because all of them are necessary. As far as I know. Anyways, let me delete that. So the first thing I do, I wouldn't actually start the timer here. Let me just make sure my mic's recording. It's had problems in the past. Okay, looks like it is. This will probably be a little rambly and a little slow, and I wouldn't be surprised if I screw up and die at some point, so I apologize in advance. If anything really bad happens, I will edit it out, and you'll see, like, a jump cut. Anyways, so the first thing I do is this. I start up my 100% game, which is saved in the museum. I wouldn't start the timer here, but I guess technically this makes this a new game plus run? I guess. This is the only thing that I do. Generally, this game doesn't really have anything you can do in one game, one file that affects another, but for some reason, any bat enemies, if you either kill them or starter them, they will remain killed or startled until you restart the game for any save file. I actually don't think they remain killed. I think they just always will be startled. And when they're startled and you're not on the screen, then they will just pick a random far-off part of the screen to go to, and they'll go to that. So basically, this is the final dungeon, and I've just removed a few of the enemies from it, which lets me go a little bit faster and a little more reckless, and also damage boosting is really important in the last dungeon, so... it's really handy to not have a few enemies right here that I don't have to slowly work my way through. Oh, and maybe I should go to a better lit spot to demonstrate something real quick. Here, here's a good place. One thing, I'll just demonstrate kind of the basic way movement works in this game. You'll see that when I stop, there's a lot of sliding, especially if I try and turn the other way. There's a lot of momentum in this game, which makes jumping feel really nice, but it's bad for speedrunning. It takes a long time to turn around. But if you crouch, you stop instantly. So if you do a crouch turn like this, you turn much faster. It actually saves a little over half a second. I forget, I timed it out once. It's like 3/4 of a second, if I remember correctly, every time you do it. So it's definitely worthwhile. Anyways, here is where I would start the timer, right when I select new game. And there's a bit of a long intro, so... There's a few parts during this run where there might kind of be some silence, some dead air, because I really don't have much to say about... There's a few parts of this run where you're kind of just going to a place, and it's the unfortunate part of this run. I try to cut that down by getting the magic bottle as soon as I can, but... Anyways, I'll talk about that when I get to it. For most of my commentary on this run, I'll kind of be assuming you know you have played this game. If you haven't played this game, stop watching this. Go play it. It's a really fun game. It's really one of my favorite games of all time, and it's totally free. You can find it by searching Treasure Adventure Game. You can get it by having a good old games account. It's free. There's a million ways you can download it. They're coming out with a remake sequel. Prequel, I don't know, called Treasure Adventure World, which I'm pretty excited for. I think it'll actually be a little worse for speedrunning, but that's probably because it'll be a better made game. I guess I can talk a little bit about the game, for those of you who haven't played it or don't know about it, during this little intro. Other than the music, I believe it was entirely made by one guy, Steven Orlando? I hope I got his name right. I'm a little bit of a brain fart there. But, when he started making this game, I don't think he knew any programming, and he'd never made a game before, so he learned as he was making this. And it actually works really... When you say that, I mean, he actually made a prototype for this called Karma, but I think this was really his first finished game. So you'd expect it to be a buggy mess, but playing normally, it's really not. I know a few ways that make this game likely to crash, but again, but basically playing casually, you probably won't run into any bugs, but there's a lot of really strange things about the way it works that are, I think, a result of him learning how to code as he goes along. There's some tricks that work in one area that don't work in another, for instance, even though it looks like the same object. Oh, as a note, I guess you want to go indoors as soon as possible. It's a surprisingly big time saver over the course of the game. Oh, and I can talk about mashing too. There's an attack button and an action button. You can use them both, and I find that the most efficient to mash through text. I find the most efficient way to mash through text is to syncopate them one after the other, so that you finish the text box and then you skip to the next one. Seems a little faster. So my goals right now are to. The beginning of the game is pretty standard. You can't really break it that much. I have a certain amount of coins I need to get, and I want to do everything on the world map very quickly. Because there's a temple I have to get to that closes at a certain time of day. It's only open at certain times of day, and if I do everything perfect and get lucky with the wind when I get the sail from my boat, then I'll be able to make it to the temple. Probably I will not make it to the temple in this run, in part because I'm going a little slow to demonstrate things, and in part because, even if you do everything perfect, there's like a 50% chance that the wind is against you enough you can't do it. But I have a save prepared, so I'll just load that save up. And also, I should mention, I went in that item shop earlier, in part so I could get the coins, and in part because the door at the top exits slightly more right. And so that saves me... I basically want to save as much time on the world map as possible so I can make it to the temple. So that saved me, like, not very much. Like, 2 body lengths, probably like a second of walking. But I've missed the temple door by a second. I've had it close on me. So every second you can spend where you're going to the right, not on the world map, is really helpful. So that's the other reason I went in the item shop. And you have to talk to the grandpa. You can't. The museum's closed until you do. Boat mechanics. Every time you land in the boat, you scoot forward a few pixels. So you have to get a good rhythm of mashing the A button as often as possible while still falling as quickly as possible. You just want to do short hops, basically. Oh, and you do want to do the quick turn on this door, because it actually is a different... You're not really loading into a different area, so you're actually in the same room, so your momentum carries over when you go through that door. It's the thing you might see me do a couple other times. Your swing comes out all around you, but it comes out behind you first. So if you want to hit something fast, you want to hit it with the backswing, because it comes out sooner. I should have marked in there, whatever. A lot of this game is just knowing when to damage boost as well. A lot of the routing is based on that. Generally speaking, there's a lot of saves that I'll be going near but wouldn't ordinarily take in a run that I might take here just... Since this is more of a slow exploration, I might die, and then you'd have to wait. You can talk to the door here instead of talking to Bagus, and he just automatically talks to you. They're very nice about that. Blah, blah, blah. So now I have to go get the compass and then the sail. And I'm collecting coins so that I can buy the compass. And generally speaking, there's 3 things I have to buy in this run. I have to buy the compass, which will be pretty soon. I have to buy the blue hat, which I'll explain when I get to it, if you don't know what that does. It actually does something. And I have to buy the shark repellent, which which is just necessary to get the last treasure. One of the last treasures. Unless you have, like, max health, you need the shark repellent. These jumps are surprisingly tricky to do quickly, anyway. Is a secret hidden up here of some coins? They're kind of buggy. Oh, it didn't happen this time, but sometimes you, like, won't pick them up even though you're on them. Try to avoid jumping. It makes it less likely to happen. That's why I just got the bottom row and then the top row coming back left. And now I have enough coins. There's a little bit of randomness with these coins. There's one chest that I either will or won't open, depending on how many coins I have. Every chest spawns a slightly random amount of coins. And there's always a chance I'll get a few from enemies. So there's one chest towards the end of the run that I will get. Oops, I'll get if I don't have enough coins. Wow, that was a little awkward. My timing was off since I lost it the first time. I think the fastest way is to drop the rock on the spider, but I haven't actually timed that. I could be wrong. It might be faster to try and squeeze by him. You'll probably get hit, but I don't know that that's necessarily slower. I should probably double check that. Oh, and I did a damage boost off that spider earlier. So you want to not get hit by both of the spiders walking in that hallway, or you can't damage boost off the jumping spider. So I'm here to buy the compass, and I'm also here to do my first clip zip of the game, which I'll explain before I do it. So, collision detection in this game is kind of... I like to think of it as collision suggestion. You notice when I crouch, I get wider, which makes sense. You're laying down. And right on this mound, it sort of shoves me to the side, because I think I'm actually inside of it for just a moment, and then it shoves me out. But if you do it on this side, it doesn't know where to put you. And if you just hold down and left while you crouch, it'll shove you into the wall, and then the wall will shove you down. And actually, I was still holding left because I was talking, but you usually fall right down onto this map. And that way you can get the map and the compass all together. And I'm gonna grab this since I have 2 health, and technically the Pondos could kill me. I probably wouldn't ordinarily wait for that fruit, but whatever. If you get hit by a piranha, it technically slows you down because it knocks you up in the air and then you don't get to do one jump on the boat. It's a really minor time loss, but... There's a few places in the run, though, where I want to keep as much health as possible to damage boost later, and the piranhas can really screw you over in that regard. But in the early part of the run, it really doesn't matter if you get hit by a piranha, unless you've really screwed up in the tree or something and took extra damage and the piranha might kill you. If you have taken any damage, then you can just grab this apple. It's really handy. Anyways, I'm going to go to the worm caves now so we can get the sail. You can't go anywhere without the sail. This game is very limiting until you get your first treasure. And then it really until you get the shovel. Actually, really until you get the lockpicks, if I'm gonna be honest. Once you have the lockpicks, the game intentionally really opens up for the player, and that's when we get to pick and choose where we want to go. So that's when the routing opens up as well. Until then, it's pretty much intentional. I mean, I'm doing a few tricks here and there to make certain areas go faster, but I'm basically playing as intended. Let's see, when does this door close? Oh, that's not great. I saw a stutter there as it loaded. Oh, I didn't get it. There's a trick I've gotten exactly once here, where I open up the door before the bird talked to me. I think I managed to land and hit up where the door is before I landed on the ground. The bird talks to you as soon as you touch the ground near that area. And if I only did it once, and I tried to do it repeatedly, and I couldn't recreate it. I haven't put that much effort into recreating it. I think I know how you do it. I think I'll just have to land very far to the right and then mash up at the right time. I'm not sure it's even always possible. I don't know. Only ever happened once. Anyways, that stuttering earlier worried me a bit, because my hard drive is kind of failing, and this game has frozen, I think, because my hard drive is kind of failing. So hopefully that won't happen during this run. It's faster to throw rocks than to carry them, except, wow, that's bad. Okay. Usually it's three throws, and then you carry it past the fire because the fire will block the rock, and then you throw it off, but I threw too early. One really obvious trick that I think everyone just learned, in fact you have to do it at one point, is you can jump up and then hit up, and then you're a little ways up a tunnel. You have to do it right there, I guess. This guy will talk to you if you get close to him, but if you jump over and land on the rock, you'll skip his trigger and he won't talk to you, and instead you'll just jump on the block and break his back instead of saving him. If you do talk to him, you don't have to save him, but you have to have the conversation with him, so it's a bit of a time loss. And you don't have to push this block all the way into the divot, you can just push it right here-ish. You just need to be able to jump up into that area. There's really not going to be much to talk about for this part. I think this is probably the most boring part of the run, because there's just not really anything going on. I apologize for that. I wouldn't ordinarily take the save, because you totally don't need to, and I generally take saves if I have to refresh my health, because if you're having a real run, you wouldn't, but I'm just going to take the save. On the off chance something goes wrong, I just don't wanna. It's right there, it's so easy to take. And this isn't a real run anyway, because I'm stopping to talk. Got it. If you do a quick turn there, when you crouch, your body actually gets wider, and you can just hit the button while turning around. Save a little bit of time. There's a lot of places we want to do a quick turn as you fall off something, like right here I did it, or I tried to and I failed. You just have to do it before you jump off. If you jump in the wind here, it speeds you up a bit. Ooh, I cut the edge, that's not great. What? Wow, that's not good. Missing my easy jumps. Man, what is that? Sorry about that. Can't say I've missed that jump in a long time. This dude can randomly decide to hit you. If you anticipate it, he can knock you up. This bit, I'm still messing it up sometimes, but there's a consistent setup. I didn't quite get it, but there's a consistent setup where you can just hit right, left, and not have the bird land. Oops. Man, I'm not playing well. Sorry, folks. It was a long day. I would expect this run to not be a great run, even if I wasn't doing it slowly and talking a bunch. There we go. There's a little trick here, which is pretty obvious, but you can drop the rock and you'll automatically shoot up into the spike, as long as you're just holding right. It's not terribly precise. It's a little tricky. I'm taking this, because there's a chance the spiders up ahead will kill me if I do really poorly. If I could find a way to get past that fire, I could get a I could maybe get a treasure early, although I think I'd probably need the magic bottle to progress in this dungeon. But there's a treasure up top, so I don't know. But I haven't even been able to get past the fire, and if you did, you'd have to find your way to glitch around a whole lot of obstacles without the bottle, so I'm not sure it's possible even if you could get past that fire. But it might be helpful. So I'm gonna not solve this puzzle correctly, because it's a little faster to do so. If you just hold left, you will be inside the block, and then you push the other block. And then here, you push them like this, and then you just mash left and right while crouching a few times and you'll shove them apart. Doesn't really matter what you do, you just have to mash left and right to shove them apart, because if they end up touching each other, and you've got a pretty limited time to do that, because you'll be pushed out of the block if you don't, and then you can't solve the puzzle if they're touching each other next to each other, and you'll have to go out of the room to reset it. When you pick up any item or treasure, if you hit the dialogue button at the right time, you'll interrupt the dialogue showing up, and you'll save like one button press, and the dialogue box will stay on the screen and be empty until you leave the room. It's incredibly minor. Fire? Nope. Okay. If you hit the right side of that fire, it'll shoot you over to this wall. It's not really any faster, because if you do that room perfectly, you'll be past the fire before it ever starts. But instead, I lost a lot of health, so now I'll probably... Oh, I have to play this part really safe now, actually. I just realized. Because doing this fast... Not this part, but this part... to do this fast, you will take damage from one of these spiders. But instead, I'm going to do it slow. Ordinarily, I'd just hold right here, and I'd tank damage from one of them while probably killing the other, if you do it perfect. But yeah, because I took too much damage, I couldn't do that. Trying to show off the fire boost, which isn't really useful anyway. Anyway, so that kind of slowed me down a bit, which isn't great for the temple, but I think I'm making good time. But at this point, what really matters is wind, what direction the wind is going. I'm pretty much going to hold right until I get to the temple. And if I get good wind, I will make it, and if I don't get good wind, I won't. It's just not much you can do. It's pretty much RNG. I haven't really done the math, but I think if you do everything on the world map perfectly, you have like a roughly 50% chance, give or take. It's not terrible, but it's not great. He will talk to you here. You have to talk to him. You can't talk to the door here. If you do, you'll leave, and then he'll actually talk to you outside and bring you back in. So you actually have to talk to him. And you need full health for an upcoming boost, so you do want to save there, unless you have full health. Which you shouldn't, because you should have taken damage. Oh no, I guess if you did everything perfect, you would take 2 damage from the spider. And then you could heal that with the apple. So then you wouldn't save. But I usually find that I want to save there. A pretty good wind. It's not bad. One of these... Okay. If one of these piranhas hits me, as he's... delightfully just demonstrated, it's not too bad. It just means I'll save in here instead. It takes a little longer to get to the save point, so it's not ideal, but whatever. I do need full health for a skip up coming up. And if this guy is... if you're making really good time, this... whoops, I just screwed up. That bush monster will not be there if you're making really good time, because he's only there at night. And you can get here just before it's... if he is there, it doesn't necessarily mean you're not going to make it to the temple in time, but it's not a good sign. Basically, if he's not there, then you're guaranteed to make the temple, I think, unless you really screw stuff up. I think I'm going to take a safety save up ahead. I'm not feeling confident in my abilities today. Okay, I talked to the bird there, which lets me fall through the quicksand really quickly, and I should probably explain that, so I'll just take a moment to do that here. Actually, not next to the cactus, I won't. He's gonna get in my way. I'll do it up here. Okay, so, this is probably the most important trick that I've found. I don't really have a name for it. Bird skip? I don't know. Basically, this bird is really, really powerful. He breaks time and space. So when you talk to him, he says stuff. And I remember I said earlier that when you stop moving, you have a lot of momentum, so you keep sliding forward. So if you walk forward and you talk to him, you slide forward, like, I don't know, almost a full body length. Which puts you in a dialogue state while moving, which lets you do a lot of funky things. Like I just showed you, quicksand and some elevators, for quicksand and for some moving platforms, you'll just fall straight through them instead of either falling slowly or being carried by them. Don't worry about this trick, I'll explain it later. So yeah, it's really handy. It's also, its main use though, bird skip, is for skipping boss and cutscene triggers, which I'll show later. This trick is really obnoxious, and if you fail it, you die, basically. But when you jump on this fire, it launches you back and away. Actually, well, since I just took damage, I'll just show you. Wait, what? Huh, I just got really lucky in a way, except not really. Okay, so I'm just gonna die here. I can't not die here. But what's supposed to happen is you jump on the fire and it knocks you away. Like that. It's supposed to knock you back in from the direction you jumped in. Every once in a while it won't, which is really inconsistent. But there's a way to make it 100% consistent, as long as you do it right. Basically, if you mash the opposite direction just before you hit the fire, you will get launched the way you want to go, like that. So I jump and I hit right before I hit the fire. It's relatively exact, but it's not too punishing. And then you hold left again, or you won't have the momentum. As soon as you hit the fire, you'll hold left, so that you actually keep moving left. It's a little tricky to learn, and it's kind of a pain to learn, since you, if you screwed up, you die. Oh yeah, and you don't generally get hurt by things while in dialogue mode. I don't think there's anything that will hurt you. So I walked right through that cactus. And I used the bird skip to get down here. And that heart isn't just for fun. A, it helps a lot because it lets me do a lot more damage boosting. And a lot of things do 2 damage in this game, so having 1 extra health is really helpful. Because it basically turns your effective health from 3 to 4. In a lot of situations, but I also actually need that 7th health to do a specific skip later in the game that you cannot do with 6 and you need 7. And I wouldn't ordinarily save there, but hey. Whatever. Anyways, I'm probably not going to make the temple at this point. Although the wind's been pretty solid, maybe I will. We'll see. And you just mash A on it. Pretty standard. To save a couple extra seconds here, you want to damage boost off this cactus. To grab onto the ring, you actually have to land on a specific part of him. Just try and land on the leftmost spike. He's got like 3 spikes on the top of his head. I just think of trying to land on the left one. Oh, I almost got crab boost. If you land on one of those crabs after jumping off the mushroom, you'll usually keep your mushroom's momentum for a while because the crab will knock you upwards. It's completely random, and actually will almost never happen with this routing. Yeah, the door's already closed. I'm way too late. I didn't do that well on this run, but that's okay. There's a save point in this shack, and I have a save point that starts in that shack, so I'm just gonna quickly swap those out. Where is it? I have a lot of saves. Wait, where is it? Okay, there it is. This game's really nice. You can actually swap saves out anytime, and it'll just read them. So I just deleted one save and then copied a save and renamed it to the right save. I just save file underscore game save underscore one, and I'm in the right and it just works. So it's really nice about that. You don't need to quit the game or anything. Anyways, this save starts here. This is roughly the in-game time that I would be getting here. Maybe a little early. Actually, yeah, it is early. I'm actually gonna wait. I don't know. I have a few less coins than I did before. I actually set up this save on the assumption that, like, I got about as few coins as I could. Which isn't terrible. These beetles can be real jerks because they're random and they can bounce you around. But actually, he knocked me without doing damage. Thanks, buddy. That was actually a really good position for them. Sometimes that one's right under the underhang and he can sort of stunlock you into the wall. It's Oh, a thing about digging, you can't just, if you mash it, well, no, not here. Well, that made me look like a fool, but if you mash it in some places, you'll start digging before you land on the sand properly, and you'll just do a dig animation like this without digging through the sand. So you don't want to mash it, you want to press it every time you land on a piece of sand if you're digging multiple pieces at once. Except there, apparently. um, Oh, I'm doing a little trick here, actually. If I just jump off here, I can't make that. And I have to jump up to here and then get a running start. Actually, that wasn't even enough for a running start. But there's a little trick you can do, and I do this in a couple other places. Basically, while you're on a ledge, you can build up momentum. And, like, you'll see I'm holding left here, and I move sort of a pixel to the left. And I can hit right and move to the right. So it actually lets you move while you're hanging. It just doesn't let you move. It's as if you go off away from the wall, then you fall off. So if you just hold left for a moment to build up momentum, you can make that jump. So it's only like a... Oops, that's not good. Wow, I need practice on this one, apparently. Really? Sorry, folks. I'm not doing this one well. I'm kind of surprised. I did it first try, and now I'm like... Oh well, sorry about that. Anyways, doesn't save much time there. It saves a bit more time actually right after this next temple, and then I'm not sure I use it again. But it's... Oh yeah, you can do that. It's not helpful. But it's a minor time saver, but it's not terribly hard to learn. There's no trick for this, you just push the block. Which I guess there's a little bit of a trick. You don't have to push it all the way to the edge. You just need to make it close enough that you can crawl over the gap. It's not much of a trick, but it saves a little bit of time. Sometimes, I guess I pushed it too close, but if you don't push it close enough, they won't die. And the spiders will just kind of get stuck in the rock instead. You can boost on that crab to get to the second level of this temple, but it doesn't do anything helpful. I guess just say, I've been assuming for all this commentary that you've played this game, I think I said that, but if you haven't, this is a pretty neat puzzle, temple-wide puzzle, where you do a bunch of block pushing. And actually, I think a trick that a lot of people found, including myself, is there's a way to clip through this temple using a block and shoving it to the right wall. In a lower area, but I found a faster way to do it. If you just go here, and you stand right here, and then you knock this thing on top of you, if you're still facing right, you'll go on top of it. Let's get out of there. Oops. Wait, you're gonna explode if I stand there. But if you face left, you'll go down, and he'll be on top of you. So, yeah, just come closer. Oops. There we go. That was a little ugly. It's usually a lot smoother if you just go straight for it. It's usually just set up properly. So yeah, just make sure to whack him while facing right and then turn left before he lands on your head, and no problem. Oh, and there's a cutscene trigger to start this boss that's right... It's like the third block over, the line that divides the second and third blocks from the left. Although I guess it's like one monolithic block, but you can pretend. So I want to talk to my bird as I slide across that trigger, and it'll let me get an early hit. And the other guy running this, whose name is like... Oh my god, I forgot it again. I'm sorry. Chrome... something? But I saw on his YouTube channel, he's got a quick kill for this boss that I don't fully understand, and I might try and go for it. He uses this to get an early hit. And then he bounces off the spike hands to bounce back on the head. And I've seen that happen, and I've done it, but I don't know how to do it consistently. But he does it twice in a row. Says he can do it consistently. I don't know how that works. It's some sort of specific timing that I don't know. But basically, you can quick kill this boss, but I don't know how to do it. So I do it my own way, which is a lot slower. But if you attack, you interrupt one of his attacks. You want to interrupt the attack where he's moving his hands back and forth, because that takes longer. And yeah, he lets you up here every 3 cycles, so you just go 3 cycles and then hit. Oh, I should have skipped that one. I thought it was the other. You can tell which way the attack he's doing by the way his hands rotate. I didn't skip the longer attack, which is my fault. Oh, and you can't hit that guy with the throwing hook. they don't expect you to have the throwing hook. Oh, and I'm gonna do that ledge momentum thing I mentioned earlier for all of these, because otherwise you have to jump up. And I'm gonna fail it, apparently, because today's not my day. It's really not that hard, I promise. Well, now I'm on top, so whatever. That's embarrassing. But you can do it on every one of those, and it's faster. Oops. Whatever. So, I'm walking back now to get lockpicks, but on the way there, A, I'll be fighting a mini-boss, which I won't actually be fighting, and B, I will be getting my second treasure, which is something that the game allows you to do normally, but doesn't necessarily expect you to do. But I think it's actually kind of intended that you can get two treasures before you bother going back for lockpicks. And I'm saving here in case I screw up this next trick. I'm itching my eye, because my eye is itchy. Okay, so the pirates, I'm going to do another bird skip on these pirates, combined with some other stuff. The pirates appear, I have notes that give me the x-coordinates for things, because thankfully you have a compass that tells you x-coordinates of things, which is really handy to have. Because it tells you exactly where to skip some things and where some treasures are. And if the compass got skipped on this run, it would be a much bigger pain to do. But anyways, the trigger for the pirates is right in between x-coordinate 299 and 300. So I want to slide across that. Hopefully I don't screw it up. That was way too soon. Better too soon than too late. There we go. You can tell you get it because this music changes. So now I'm going to walk into them and then turn right, which will shove me up. While I'm still, I'm inside of them, so it's just shoving me up. While I'm being shoved up, you can hold right, and then you, if you hold right, it'll shove you to the left while you're still going up, and then you can hit, once you're actually on top, you can hit left, and you just slide off, and skip the whole fight. That's a really long fight. Unfortunately, the game now thinks I'm in, the game is pretty sure I'm still fighting a boss. And in that boss. And in that boss, the screen doesn't change, so the screen is now fixed. But thankfully there's a way to fix that, and I've got some coordinates written down, but I kind of know these. At 222, the land starts, so at 222, I just start jumping, and I pretty much hold the jump button for a full-length jump, and then hold it again, and I don't have to slow down. And I do that until I get to x-coordinate 173. And x-coordinate 173, I have to run to and jump off, and I did not make it. And I know I've made it because I'll hear some grass rustling, so I'll be quiet for a sec. Yeah, so that means you made it. And then you just walk a few more steps to the left and you hit up. And then you save here, you quit to the main menu, and you go back into game, and now, it's all fixed, and the screen scrolls and everything, everything's great. So yeah, what I jumped off was this, and I know I made it because I hear landing on this. Makes a little, very soft grass rustling noise. And the grass doesn't make that noise, so I guess it's a leaf rustling noise. And if you're curious, you actually can't progress through the rest of the dungeon with that fixed screen, because since you're not on the screen, certain things don't seem to load in if you're not on screen, or they don't interact. So I've gone right to where this mushroom is and jumped, and there's no, it doesn't, it's not there, it doesn't exist. So you can't jump off it and go to the rest of the dungeon. You can't do the rest of the game. It's just blind. Not that you'd want to. So anyways, we're gonna get this treasure since we're right here. We're actually passing through the tree either way, so we might as well stop and get it. Mushroom's now grown. I don't remember exactly what triggers that. I think it's getting the first treasure. What you're supposed to do here... Whoa, that was interesting. I wonder if if there's a clip there. Probably not a useful one. Anyways, what you're supposed to do here is grab an apple and bring it back down and feed it to a spider, and the spider takes a long time to eat it, and then you get a lightning bug and you come back out. And the lightning bug lights up this totally dark room. But you can do this room. And in fact, even if you do this room really poorly, you still save time. I think you can waste like... I timed it once, and I didn't write it down because I'm not very clever, but I think you can waste like 25 seconds in this room, and you'll still save time over someone doing this room relatively sloppily with light. You save time over someone doing this room very well with light. That was my benchmark. So anyways, you just kind of walk over here. You kind of have to know... Oops, I grabbed it the first time, and then I jumped down to explain, and now I've lost my markers. That's not great. You kind of have to know where to jump there. It's not a hard jump. Then you just jump up here 3 times. Honestly, to practice this room, I would just say do it with lit and close your eyes for various parts. The jump on the far left is the hardest part. You jump up here. Maybe I should do this with the room lit so I can show you guys. Yeah, you know what? I'm going to do that. I'm going to go light this room so that you can actually see what the hell I'm doing. But imagine I was doing it in the dark. And you get to see what I skipped, too. Oh, that's right. The game doesn't expect you to get this treasure, because you're supposed to need the throwing hook to get the apple. But A, I have the throwing hook, and B, I don't need the apple. So yeah, this is what you're skipping. It's kind of cute. That whole time you just can't move. Anyway, so I usually do this in the dark, but we'll do it in the light. Oh, and you just take a few steps to the left and then throw your throwing hook and you can get under that spider without taking damage, which is nice. And then you just kind of have to know how far to walk. You can know that you've gone too far because the screen will stop scrolling. And in the dark, you can actually see a light blue glow from every one of these switches, and a few other things, so you can use them to orientate yourself. Which is the way I could, like, turn the lights on and off dynamically, but I can't, so just pretend that it's dark. So anyways, you jump up here, and then you just jump to the left until you hit the line, keep jumping until you're on this platform. You won't see the screen scroll anymore. There'll be a slight blue glow on this switch, so you'll be able to tell when the screen is scrolling. So then you just jump up here, which is an easy jump, and hit the switch, and walk to the right of this. This is probably the hardest jump in this room. Is that jump. That's probably the hardest part of this whole room, especially in the dark. The way I do it is an audio cue. I listen for 4 steps. I go all the way to the right side of the wall, then I hit left, listen for 4 steps, and jump just after the 4th step. And then I jump, and then hit right after I jump. That's kind of tricky to do in the dark, but if you listen for the footsteps, it's not too bad. I should probably be quiet again and let you listen to the audio cue. It's really quiet. You might want to turn your volume up for that audio cue, or just memorize the amount of time. I don't know. Up to you how you do it. And then you just jump on this, and I just throw it. Actually, this bit's a little tricky in the dark. I tend to fumble a bit here before I get on this side. But whatever, there's no trick to it. So then, this switch is easy. You just run to the right until you hit the wall, and then you jump, and you'll hit this wall, and then you just face the right and swing, and you'll hit it. And then this platform's really big, so it's pretty easy to land on, even in the dark. You just kind of walk a few steps to the left, and you will see the switch on the right there with its blue glow. I don't think the green switch gives off the light, but I think the mushroom does. But whatever, you can triangulate yourself. You'll just have to learn it. This is, again, pretty easy. You're here, you just hold left, you jump a few times, and then throw your hook. And I think the most consistent way to do this in the dark is to step until you fall down on this, and then you hold right and then jump, and then you're here. It's easier than doing it any other way. It's much more consistent. And then this bit can actually be a little tricky in the dark, too. I usually run to the wall and then come back and jump. And then just make sure not to jump over the switch and you're fine. The room actually won't light up at this point, either. It'll sort of get brighter, but you still can't see anything. So for this part, I just run and I mash up repeatedly until I get here. Owen. He doesn't usually talk to you.
Because he's not there.
So yeah, I wish I could go back and do that room in the dark just to show you, but... At first I thought it'd be really difficult to do that, but it turns out it's really just one jump that's hard. And one jump at the end that's kind of hard. You can't jump on that plant till it's fully grown, so you might as well push it most of the way to the right anyway, just to make the jump easier. The fastest way to do this room is technically to jump bounce off a piranha and land on the hook, but it's also random. And actually a lot of things about this room are random. Like that, right there, I'm holding A. Not good. That's interesting. That's not one of the things that's supposed to be random. I don't know what's going on with that. I'm literally just holding right and A. Oh well, and then I'm missing the hook, which is not random. That's me being bad. Really? Wow, I'm really not doing well. Sorry, this is not hard. I'm just bad. There we go. Sorry about that. A weird quirk of this room is that sometimes if you're hanging on that hook and you hold A to jump off it, you won't land on this pipe and you just land back on the hook. And that can happen a couple times in a row. I really don't understand it, but it happens. This boss is kind of random, unfortunately. His first and third stages are random at 20 legend attack, so I just throw a I try and throw a hook for when he could be, and then I swing my hook repeatedly right there. Sometimes he'll go, and then here I should swing my hook again. Oh, if you talk to the bird here, you'll fall down. And I should say, as long as I've got time paused, when he's on the right platform, I go to the right side of the platform and I swing my hook repeatedly while facing right, and sometimes he'll go into his vulnerable state twice in a row there, and he'll just finish the phase instead, which is the fastest I can go, I think. Otherwise, I just sort of throw the hook at him when he's at the middle, so that'll hit him in the middle area when he might be vulnerable, and then I throw it again when he's at the low, so that it will hit him if he becomes vulnerable, is the idea. I throw the hook at him. And I'm willing to take a lot of damage. Oh, and he can throw the balls, and then you get the last hit, and then the balls hit you during the cutscene and you die. So be careful about that. You don't want to carry this all the way, you just want to throw it on the conveyor belt. The conveyor belt's faster than picking it up and throwing it again. It's a really minor efficiency thing, but there's a lot of those in this game, so... Oh yeah, and again, talk to the bird and you fall through that. For speed. Ordinarily, I would not save here. I'm still not totally confident about this routing. I feel like I might want to save a few more health during that fight so that I'm not in danger of getting killed by piranha. Because I'm going to jump off this tree and land directly in some piranha, and you'll notice I ended with one health, which was pretty deliberate. But it might be faster to try and save, like, two health or three health, and then I don't have to save. I don't know. Ooh! Well, they don't usually hit you here, but there, as you see, he did, so there's not terrible much I can do about it, so... I don't know. The technical fastest way would be to just keep risking it and get down to one health, and then just hope the piranha don't kill you, but I'm not really crazy about that idea. So, I think probably you should try and keep a couple health. Don't need to talk to backends here. You can just go down, get your treasure. Ooh. Oops, that's bad. Nah, it doesn't really matter, I'd take a damage there anyway. See, because we have two treasures, we can, That sand is really weird. You can't dig it until the saw blade is down. I don't know why, but it's very strange. Is there a saw blade here? Yes, there is. Okay. I probably shouldn't have done that. Anyway, so because we have two treasures, we can actually get the lockpicks and then advance a little further in the dungeon here so that the shortcut is further down. These columns are the worst. They eat your inputs. You'll notice I'm juddering up and down on them. Let me see. No, it's not. Okay, they had one input there, but it wasn't a huge deal. But they can. I've been killed by this. Because I get stuck in the spike trip. But you'll see that I'm sort of juddering up and down. Some of the time, I'm actually counting as either in midair or possibly in the rock. So, they can eat your input. So I actually usually take that area pretty slowly. Although I had a lot of health there, I probably didn't have to take it that slow. But anyways, that makes it so that when we come back, we won't be coming back to this temple until we get all the treasures. But now I have, now I can go down to the second level right away, and I don't have to worry about taking damage. And for the final temple, I'll be doing a lot of damage boosting, so it's helpful to have gotten through some of the area already. And again, you can talk to the door here instead of Baggins. And you have one lockpick, and you want to buy one more. And if you forget to do it there, you can do it in the desert. There's another robot. And if you get to do it there, you can do it in every place. And those are the only two lockpicks you'll need for the game. They're to open up the cannon and to open up the tree that has the bottle in it. And now we're here. Wind's good, anyway. The wind is with me. Which is nice. But this is a very long portion of the game where I'm basically holding right. For about 8 minutes. I don't think I'll have much commentary. I might actually have to pause in the middle and grab some water, but I'll edit that out if I do. My voice is getting kind of raw. I apologize for all the ums and uhs in this. I'm easily distractible. It's a little hard for me to play and talk at the same time. That's one of the reasons I wanted to re-record this instead of using the stream that I did the other day. Because I was even more distracted there. Because I was looking at stream chat and I flubbed a lot of things and I had a couple of really embarrassing deaths. Hopefully I won't have any here. If I do, I can just edit them out. You won't even know. Strongly against me too, just to troll me. If you really want, you can probably just... Oh, well, there's one thing I can note here. There's this little shortcut block, and it's down. The trigger for it to go down is not actually pushing it down into that divot, it's just going... Whoa, interesting. I landed on the mushroom, but it didn't activate until I was sitting on it for a moment. That happens sometimes. But yeah, that shortcut block pushes itself down, so you don't have to do it. I don't know exactly what the trigger for it is, but it's probably getting one of the two treasures I have. But yeah, anyways, you can probably, if you really want to, you can skip right ahead to the jungle. I won't really be doing anything until then. I'm just running right. I don't think I'll see it here, but ordinarily... Oops, I should not have done that, because I had to crawl. Ordinarily... Oh, good wind. When I get to the city, if I was doing a real speedrun, then the day it would be the middle of the night, and when I get to the city, for just a moment, you can hear the band play. But I don't think that'll happen here. Oh wait, no, you shouldn't have skipped ahead to the jungle. When I get to the jungle, I'll tell you to go back, because you do need these coins. I forgot. I always forget till I get to them. Okay, if you do this, you'll get it for... You can go in first cycle. As long as you don't screw that up, then it's pretty simple. Probably everybody knows that, though. If you don't get that first cycle, you have to wait for, like, 5 cycles for it to be possible. Lame. So yeah, when I get to the jungle, I will tell people to rewind and watch where I got coins. I call that island Lava Land because I don't think it has a real name. It probably does. I don't know any of the island's real names. I probably should. It's on that sign. I could have just read the sign. Okay, so while we're here, we're gonna get the cannon. Oops. These, coconut... What? I thought I had jumped there. Sorry. I feel like my jump's not holding down. That might just be me being bad, though. Sorry. A lot of things are breaking in my computer, but I don't think this is wrong, and I think I'm just being terrible. Anyways. So, we're gonna get the cannon here. With that current going against us, it's really fast to jump. So the cannon's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 blocks down. Or blocks over, I should say. Tiles, I guess? 7 tiles over. One thing, when the current is with you like this, you don't want to jump. Because it'll actually slow you down, as far as I can tell. Because you're moving so fast that the little speed boost you get when you land in the boat is actually slower than just going normally. There's only a few places where the current is with you, but you want to do that. Oh, and I'm opening up at 154 here. I just mash up as I walk past it. It opens the door. I can't do anything in there yet, but it saves me the door opening animation when I come back later. Now that I have the cannon, every time you shoot the cannon, you move forward by about a pixel. So now I'm tapping jump rhythmically while mashing the cannon as fast as I can. Although there's a limit to how many you can fire. I'm not the best at this, but my advice is not to do both actions with the same hand, or you'll start to do something like you'll get into a rhythm like that, and then you're not using maximum cannons. So I actually tilt my... I play on controllers, so I actually tilt my controller sideways, and I mash the X button to shoot cannons with my left hand while tapping the A button to jump with my right hand. And I do that if I'm boating for any significant length of time. And for shorter lengths of time, I just focus on jumping and don't worry about the cannon as much. Because for shorter lengths of time, it's not worth it to like shift my grip. I don't know. I feel like trying to jump rhythmically while mashing is kind of like patting your head and rubbing your stomach. Anyways, ordinarily, since I took so long explaining some things, it's daytime, but ordinarily it would be night here. And, right as I walk past, where is it? It's this, right as I walk past here, you'd see the band playing and you get to hear their song for a few seconds. It's kind of like the halfway point of the run, intermission music. Oops. But yeah, now I'm holding right some more until I get to the magic bottle. So the basic idea behind my route, the key concept is essentially I want the bottle as soon as possible. Because it lets me use warp, it lets me do all kinds of things. You can't get in this way. You'd think you could by like falling while crouched. I think a lot of people tried it, but it's not possible. But you can get in another way, which I'll show later. It didn't jump. That's interesting. Is it because it's daytime? Maybe he's not as aggressive in the day. That bush. The bush monster is supposed to jump on you there. But I'm usually here like at night, so... I'm usually here earlier morning, I think. Whatever. It doesn't matter because he'll never... the bush monster won't hit you. And you probably have enough health to tank it anyway. Or you might not, depending on how jumping over those frogs went earlier. You do want to save here. You want to get this coin chest. It landed in front of the sign, which is bad luck, because it means I have to do that. You open this up so you can get the magic bottle. And yeah, that's the last time you use lockpicks. Save again. Ordinarily, you just save either coming or going, but I save. Because why not? It's fun times. So we've got the bottle now, and we've got throwing hook, and that means we can do these caves, but we're supposed to have dive helmet to get in the caves, but there's a trick you can do to get in here, which... oh, you saw me do it earlier to get to the save point near the throwing hook, but now I'll actually demonstrate it. So you can jump while the game thinks you're in a crouching state, and I'm doing it right here. You can tell I'm doing it because I'm doing a very short jump, and I'm sort of in a standing position. I'm actually getting a surprising amount of time, usually. Anyways, basically, you just have to hit jump and then down right after each other. That's relatively specific timing, but it's not too hard. And it looks like, I know it looks like I'm standing, but the game actually, as far as the game cares, I'm crouching when I'm doing that jump. And you can actually mash it out. Like, you can just mash it and it'll eventually work like that. That's just how I did it at first. But yeah, it lets you do jump up into overhangs like this. Most overhangs like this. Because you're in midair and then you're in a crouching state, so it lets you in the tunnel. Now, if you're really clever, you're thinking, why don't you do that little jump in the final temple and you can get to the lockpick early? And the answer is because it doesn't let you in that tunnel. For no particular reason, it just doesn't. Okay, so for this part, I'm just pretty much going to fall down very quickly. Ooh. Try and avoid getting the hallucinatory mushrooms, because it makes things harder. Smack any bubbles open. Stop here for a carrot, which maybe I didn't need. The mushrooms make the trick I'm going to do at the end of this fall kind of difficult. Shoot, well, yeah, because it's hard to make out the bubbles. I got it anyway, which you probably have no idea what I just did because I don't know how clearly it showed, but I'll demonstrate it now. So, actually, these bats are about to chase me, so I'm going to clear them by going in this... That's interesting. Why can't you? Oh, there we go. Oh, you just can't do it while you have mushroom. Anyways, I just did that to clear the bats. I wouldn't ordinarily go over here. But, so I've got a bubble right now. And ordinarily you're supposed to use the bubble once and then pop it. But there's a trick to that. So, you hit the attack button to shoot out the bubble around you. But if you're holding down, then you'll also, in addition to shooting out the bubble, you'll take out your bottle, which means you'll take out your bottle again. And that's me do this, which means I'm in a bubble while having my bottle out. And what happens now is, if I jump, the bubble is actually touching my bottle, and I'll recapture it. Like so. As long as the bubble's big enough. You see how the bubble sort of grows by five stages? Oh shoot, I didn't do it. Okay, you can also just take out your bottle while you're in the bubble. But if you want to do this max efficiently, pretty much hold down and hit X, and you'll take out the bottle while letting go of the bubble, and it's very, and then you hit A. You just can't do it too early, because you see that the bubble sort of grows and it's got five sizes. You have to wait till it gets to its third size, or it won't be touching your bottle, and then you won't be able to catch it. So you do it this fast. And if you want to go horizontal, you jump a little bit more. Well, that's weird. Knocked me backwards. Anyways. So yeah, you have to get rid of the bubble here. This room actually has a really fun route that I did, where it starts with taking the bubble and using it during this cutscene and like floating to the left while they're talking to you, but then I realized that I had no reason to actually do this room at all. The only thing I need in this room is the high jump boots. So the trigger for this cutscene is right past where the grass ends. Unfortunately, you don't get to skip the whole cutscene. You can move while they're walking. But you still have to talk to them. If you get into that cave and crawl in it before they talk to you, then when they talk to you, you'll stand up and you'll be able to walk around in there. Instead of crawling through it, you can walk through it, which is a little tiny bit faster, of course. It's barely a time saver, and I don't usually get it because you have to get the crouch jump really, really fast, and I usually panic and don't get it in time. But it feels cool when you do because you get to like walk here in the wall. And if you're wondering, can I save and quit to avoid that? If you save while they're walking over, it will actually just... And then when you load again, they'll be walking over again. So you can. But anyways, we have the high jump boots now. Great that I actually picked them up. Yes, okay. I thought I might have forgotten while talking. Ordinarily, we'd have to go through that whole room and light a torch, and then we could, you know, do the drug stuff here. But we are skipping all of that, so you don't get to see much... Ideally, you don't see me touch a mushroom once in this entire run, actually. Because we just go back down here, grab another bubble, and we're just gonna skip the whole dungeon by doing this. Oops. I should've gone to the left there. Be a little careful not to grab those vines. Sometimes you do and it gets kind of glitchy. Oh, whatever. Same position. So this boss here has a lot of fun things you can toy with him with, and I've changed the way I fight him a bunch, and I think I've recently found the best way to do it, but it's a pretty recent thing, so I might screw it up. I don't have a particularly great visual marker for where his cutscene trigger is. It's just kind of walk from right next to this divot, and you'll hit it. So I can move around this cutscene. I can't hit him right now, because I can't even do anything. But there's two parts where I can hit him during this cutscene. Right now, I could have hit him, but if I hit him here, he puts his arms... He retracts his arms, and they're over his weak point, and the game softlocks, because you can't hit him. But if you hit him here, and that's kind of tricky... If you hit him while he's lowering his arm here, his left arm will stay as lowered as it is when you hit him. So you want to hit him when his left arm is as lowered as possible, because then his weak point is exposed. So what you do is... you go to this dialogue, put him down, you beast, then you jump X, and then you smack him. It's just a specific timing. And now his left arm will stay down, and I can just miss him repeatedly, throw the throwing hook at him. You do want to be a little careful. You can get caught under his arm a bit. Anyways, in phase two, he'll stay this way. If you grab a mushroom, his arms will go back to normal, so you don't want to grab a mushroom. You just want to keep... Oh, okay, there we go. When he goes off, you can't actually hit him if he's off screen. I don't know if it'll trigger here. Okay, it didn't. So yeah, you just need to hit him 6 times like this, and you'll never have to do the either ways. There's a few other ways you can hit him as backup strats, which, if you're really curious, message me, and I will go into it. Sometimes when you hit him 6 times, he won't die, and you'll be like, what gives? And what happens there is, if he doesn't die after 6 hits, what you have to do is grab a mushroom, basically, and then wait for the... While you grab the mushroom, just run to the left. Sometimes he'll have 0 health, basically, but the game decides that he can't... That he can only die if you grab a mushroom and he turns into the hallucinatory crab thing. Forgot about this cutscene. So basically you just have to grab a mushroom and then wait for the mushroom time to run out. And then he'll just die, and you don't have to hit him again. As long as you've hit him 6 times, you don't need to hit him again, but sometimes you have to grab a mushroom. And if you do, just grab a mushroom, and then just run to the left, because then you aren't wasting time, because you can get near the gate. So, yeah. I grab these coins. They're not necessarily the best coins, but they're convenient. They sometimes can fall into the water quite a bit. But whatever. So now that we have the bottle, we can use these warp zones. Like so. Which really frees us up to go quickly. If you couldn't use warp zones in this game, I don't think I'd do this run. So yeah. You warp to the tomb, and now we're doing the tomb. Oh, I forgot to mention something else you can do with the crab. There's a couple glitched ways you can hit him. There's some damage boosts where you can boost off his claw and like land on the higher blocks when you're in mushroom mode, which is kind of handy, but the main other way to hit him as a backup strat, if he goes back to normal mode and his arm raises, if you get in one of the divots underneath him and crouch, you can let go of crouch and jump at just the right time in between his two wheels, and you can actually get stuck in his body and get a hit, and sometimes more, on him that way. I don't know if I've described that well. It's not something you sh- If you- everything goes well, you won't need to do it, but that is a backup strat. And, I don't know. I don't really have footage of that, but if you're curious, you can ask me about it. So, we can skip most- with high jump boots and throwing hook, we can skip most of this puzzle. If you stand on this button, you can jump up to the left, and you have to, as far as I can tell, you have to use the throwing hook. You can't hit it normally. A normal swing will not hit it, but if you throw your hook, you'll be able to hit the switch. Oops. I failed. So yeah, because we have high jump boots, we can do that. And we can skip the whole using the bird almost at all in this room. You're supposed to fly the bird up to get this rock, but it's actually faster to just do it yourself. Usually it's faster to throw the rock beat, not here. There's a trick here which I just realized you could do the other day, or I remembered it. If you rock left and you jump at just the last second, you can throw the rock up there, which saves you some time. Otherwise, you have to fly the bird down to get it. You don't have to move the platform all the way over, either. You can just move it far enough that your bird can fit. I actually moved it more to the left than you have to. But not by much. You can drop the rock and land right on his hat. It's real convenient. So now we're here. You can mash down and attack to use the wind repeatedly. But make sure you keep one charge of wind when you go out of that wind stream, because you want it for this dungeon. If you jump here, again, that's only possible with high jump boots, then you go here, and you use your wind, and you'll boost up to the end of the dungeon. And if you go right up to this door, and then you crouch and face to the left, you'll be inside the wall, and then as long as you keep holding left, you will get forced to the right. It's really, really simple clip. I think that's like the other clip that a lot of people found just playing casually. I don't know. I know there's a video up of it on YouTube. I don't know. I didn't find. That's one of the two. That is one of the two tricks that I took from YouTube, I think, for this run. That and rebubbling, which I took from the guy who did the 100% run, whose name I totally don't remember, and I apologize, guy. There's no particularly great way to speed this boss up, but there's one thing. Because, again, it's another height. Wow, I'm taking a lot of damage. I might actually die here. I was not paying attention. Sorry, folks. I really hope I don't. I'll actually be careful and pay attention now. Hold on. Eesh. That's a really ugly pattern, too. Yeesh. Okay, I'm good. Probably. Okay, so with high jump boots, you don't have to wait for the skeleton hand to come up. You can just jump, and if you shoot out the soul at the very tip of your jump, then it'll hit him. Other than that, there's no way to speed this up. Well, I guess there's one other thing to keep in mind. You do want to hit him as soon as possible. If you hit him late, every once in a while during one of those cycles, the soul won't show up, and you'll have to wait a whole nother cycle. But it seems to me that that happens if you hit him really early, like as soon as he's vulnerable, it doesn't tend to happen. It seems to mostly happen when you hit him late. There's also a possibility, maybe I should have shown this off, it's too late now, but there's maybe a possibility of skipping the whole boss. If you go back here during the boss fight, you can actually latch onto this, and I think you can even stand on like the lip here, but I couldn't find a way to clip through because this wall is still solid. But there's maybe a potential for skipping the whole boss there. I'm not sure. Oh, and if you're curious about the music, the crab boss really screws up music until you restart the game. If you die on the crab boss, there's a very good chance that when you load your save... Wait, was I supposed to save? Speaking of save? I'm pretty low on health. I'm not usually this low on health. I should have saved in the witch's cabin, actually. But I didn't, so I'm just going to save down here. Ordinarily, since I didn't save in the witch's cabin, I would just sort of go for it, but whatever. This is an explanation run, not a real speedrun. And in a real speedrun, I would have been like, man, I'm low on health. I better save in the witch's cabin. But I was instead talking, so... Anyways, where was I? Oh yeah, so if you die at the crab boss and continue right there, there's a good chance that the music will be playing incredibly slowly and low-pitched. And after you fight the crab boss, that music doesn't play right again. At least not for a while. Anyway, so you want to grab the warp. It's very rare that I take that much damage. So I would have ordinarily not saved, and I'd just go straight here. But I only had 2 health, and these things do 2 health worth of damage, so I just want to be careful. So you go here, and you get the dive helmet, which we need to get the 4 treasures that are submerged. No way around that. And again, just use the warp to get here. I don't know another way to get out of here other than pushing this block. So... very fun, but hey. It's just to make sure you get the dive helm. Oops, missed a jump. Ooh. So yeah, use the warp. We're just going over here, but it's still faster to use the warp. Now, if you don't have like 92 coins at this point, you'll want to dig up this chest. Because we need 100 coins once we're done with this upcoming dungeon. And I only had, again, I think basically because I had a save that had 20 coins instead of 33 at the Shuffle Temple, there's just no way I was going to get enough coins without that. But yeah, if you've got like 92 coins, then there's, how many coins are in here? Four? Five? There's like 6 coins in here, and then there's a couple more you can get for free outside. So yeah, you could get these two as well if you really need them. But I had like 73 coins, so there was no way I was going to get 100. Okay, so for this room, you want to jump from the door, and you jump behind this panel, which actually gets you a charge of wind in your bottle. And you push this block here, and then you can nudge this block just a few pixels to the right, which lets you jump up here and push it. Which opens that door, and then you can use the charge of wind you kept from earlier to get here, and then you grab another one, and you go right here, and you, again, you get another charge of wind as soon as you use it, and, you don't do that. Here, you just jump, and then you use it to get here, then you fall in this hole, and again, we're going to use wind and grab wind on our way up, so we do that, and then we do it again, and you can just jet all the way up here, which is faster than doing jumps. Oh, and, if you hold right as soon as you're in here, you don't have to worry about these guys hitting you. I don't think I held right, though. I think I actually hesitated for a second. but yeah, if you hold right, the timing is just perfect that you just jump and you go right past them. But I was not holding right. Oh, and you can, if anybody wants to do a 100% run, this isn't any percent run, right? But I found a trick that's useful for 100%. Basically, you do the thing where you wait here to spawn this. A dimensional fragment, which I'm not gonna wait that long. I have to wait for like a full minute. But if you spawn that, and then don't pick it up, and you leave this room and come back, there will be a dimensional fragment. Hold on, let's go this way. So yeah, if you spawn that dimensional fragment, but you do not pick it up, then it will still be there. But there'll also be one here. It'll be see the dimensional fragment on the left there. That will slowly float through the wall until it gets here, and if you pick it up when it's here, it doesn't count as picked up. And you can keep leaving the room and re-entering, and then waiting like 20, 30 seconds for it to come through the wall, and you can pick it up again. So that's about a minute of setup, and then 30 seconds per dimensional fragment, but there's some dimensional fragments that take longer than a minute and a half to get, so that might be a faster way to do it. I don't know if you'd even count that as 100%, because you're not picking up some of them, but you could end up with 40 dimensional fragments, so. And I assume they work at the shop, but I've never tested. In an ordinary run, I would go to the left here, but there is a trick you can do here, but it's very hard, and I think it might even just not always be possible. Or maybe I'm just bad. But basically, if you jump on this lever... Oh my god, I got it! Hey! There's that. You just have to jump as soon as you land, and it doesn't quite trigger it to go down. Or at least not enough that you can't jump up here. So, I don't usually go for that because it saves... What? Shoot. I didn't look at my health. I was so happy about getting the trick. Okay, I'm gonna, I'll cut this point. I'm gonna cut here and then I'll skip ahead to there. So that you don't have to watch me get back. And we're back. So, yeah, that chompy monster does 3 damage. I think it's the only thing in the game that does. And I didn't even know how much health I had, so... Anyways, so... Oh, I got it again! Oh my goodness, maybe I should start doing this more regularly. I don't usually go for it, because it saves so... It doesn't really save much time, and it costs a lot if you fail. And I get it less than half the time, but I've got it twice in a row now, so... don't know, maybe I should do it. Anyways, sorry about all that. If you don't hang on that ledge, you don't take damage. If you hang on the ledge and jump up, you'll take damage from the guy. If you do end up having only 3 health. Oh, I guess there's... You don't need to throw that rock. You want to stand on there while holding the rock, and that's enough to push the switch down. Unlike the other switch earlier in the caves. And so then once the switch goes down, you just want to throw the rock. And you'll get here right when this... If you hold right as soon as you do that, you get here right when this elevator's coming down, and you can just jump into it from underneath. It's pretty fun. On this part, you'll notice I can't run left and right. It's a really minor efficiency here, but, I like pointing out how weird that is, but also you can just jump to the right and get a slight head start. You can't run left or right, but you can still jump. And I'm gonna grab a carrot on the way down, because I'm gonna want full health. And I literally land on a carrot, so... Okay, so I'm gonna go here. And it's actually very late in the day right now. Ordinarily, you would get here... Actually, I'll show you. Real quick. Ordinarily, if you actually... You know, if you hadn't waited around a lot, you'll generally get here... Well, the moon is pretty low in the sky, kind of just very early morning, and the shop won't be open yet. And we're going in the shop here, so generally you want to wait until the sun is, like... that might actually be a bit late. Maybe it's a bit early, I don't know. Anyways, make sure to grab the warp on your way here. Do grab the warp, and don't use it, because we're using that to leave. Oh, it was way early. Shoot, I'm way early. Okay, well, okay, there it is. I was a little early there. Cost me some time. So, if I hit X at any point in the shop, including during dialogue, I will use the warp, and it won't come out. Because you can't use a warp inside this building. You can only use it on the world map. So it'll just let it out, but nothing will happen. But I want to buy this hat, so make sure to use the Y button, or it might not be Y button for you. Make sure to use the action button, the talk to your bird button, the shovel button, to do the dialogue here. Otherwise, you will use your warp. And if you don't use your warp, then you can go out here and use it right away, and start instead of having to walk all the way back to the left, which is a pretty big time saver. So now we're going back to the tomb. You can be anywhere on the island in warp, of course. So we're here. Oh, and we, I keep saying we. I guess it's kind of weird. I got that carrot to have full health because I'm going to be doing a dive section here that benefits from having more health. It's a little safer, and you can go faster by just taking damage to walk through things. Oh, and again, this is one of the things I have written down on my notepad. By which I don't mean a physical notepad, I mean notepad.exe. But 724 is the coordinate here, although I actually go in at 722. Oops, I forgot to hold left. So if you hold left... If you hold left... Actually, hold on, I'll simulate this realistically. Or, shit. I've bollocked it up. Okay, so ordinarily, I'll just reset this, and while I'll explain it while I'm resetting it. But basically, these mines all follow you. If you hold left, you will take damage from the first mine. Come over here this way, please, folks. Thank you. You'll take damage from the first mine, but not from the rest. If you just hold left and don't hit A at all. I hit A because I was, like, talking. Actually, let me draw them. And all, yeah, okay, all the mines will be drawn to the left. So, you can just leave on there. So, you'll blow up one mine, and you'll be able to leave on the right when you go. So yeah, that's the most efficient way to do that. If you go to left, you don't take damage from that tentacle. I think avoiding damage on the way down is probably best here. Just so that you know how much health you can afford to take on the way back. I'm not totally sure. This is not actually that well routed, honestly. I think I did not do it this time as efficiently as I could have, because I sort of sat around and waited. But yeah, ultimately you just want to take damage to tentacles, and it's These mines cannot hurt you because they're all on the left. There is one thing you have to worry about. There's a spike ice monster right as soon as you get out, and he can hit you. He doesn't like to attack immediately after you come out. He seems to have a waiting period, so you're usually fine. But just keep an eye out. He has an animation before he attacks. So just watch for it. You should be alright, though. Now we're going back to the tomb to get to the warp there, so we can warp to the city. Oh, and there'll be another thing with time of day, which might be off since I am going slowly and explaining things. And it's the last time of day is important. I think we'll be normal, though, since I reset it at the... Yeah, I think it'll be normal. Basically, it should be daytime when I get to the city, and I need it to be daytime. And if it's not daytime, it's worth waiting for it. Okay, yeah, it is. Okay, cool. So I want it to be daytime so I can go in the Globotech building, because taking the elevator there is faster than going all the way to the right and taking that elevator. And it's actually worth waiting. Even if it's night, it's faster to wait for it to be daytime. And then just to take this elevator. It's a nice elevator. And we do want to get full health here. We could have saved in the pawn shop, but this save point's a lot closer to the door, so it's better to do it here. Really like these clouds and the way they work. Took me a while to figure it out when I first played them. Now, we're pretty low on coins. If you have, like, 20 coins, you don't have to get this chest, but... What? Okay. That's really interesting. I don't know what's up with that. I got 0 coins from that chest. Okay! I've never had that happen before. Alright. I'm gonna have to stop for coins somewhere then. I don't know, that's really crazy. Anyways, usually, if you time things right, you'll get here right about now. And, so the fastest way to do this is to damage boost up on this thing. Because I was astonished by lack of coins. You have to make sure to pick up the coins quickly so that you can make that cycle, but I'm pretty sure you can while still getting the coins. And if you have, like, 15 or 20, then you probably don't need to stop. And shouldn't. And then you can easily make that cycle and damage boost your way up there. Man, where am I gonna get 20 coins? Shoot. That really threw me for a loop. I'm gonna have to improvise here. I'm not really sure. I know of some earlier, but I don't know of any like chests I'm gonna be walking across. Oh, there's a save point here too. The library's closer, right? Yeah, it is. Okay. Slightly close to the door. Whatever. Okay, so I'm gonna have to... I'm trying to think if there's a chest in the... Okay, I think I know of one I can get. Sorry. Anyways, I don't want this warp point. So, now we're gonna go get another underwater treasure. Sorry about the pause, I just had to reroute in my head. There actually is a very rare chance that you will get lockpicks from a chest. Sometimes you will get... I don't know that it ever happens with any of the chests I get on my run, though. I'm not sure, but I've never actually seen it happen with any chest I pick up on my run. But it might not be random. It might be that they're just specific chests that have lockpicks. But I think it's random that you can get a random lockpick, and sometimes you can get a random lockpick and some coins, and sometimes you can get 3 lockpicks and no coins, which would be really bad. Whoa, I just got bubble to bubble. Okay. That's awkward. You pretty much just want to do this area while avoiding the bubbles. We don't have the flashlight, so it's hard to see. In fact, on YouTube, I don't know how well you can see this at all. I'm hoping you can see it well. If not, just know that I'm pretty much doing this diving section as intended. Except, on the way up, I may take some damage intentionally. I took one damage intentionally. Yeah, you're supposed to have the flashlight for those areas, but you don't need it. And in fact, when I first played this game casually, I didn't get the flashlight until after I'd gotten all the treasures and beaten the game. No, that's not true. No, that's not true. But I had gotten almost all the diving treasures. I'd gotten 3 of the 4 treasures you dive for. Including the 2 hardest ones. So, I just assumed that it was supposed to be hard to see. Oh, I just ignored something that I should have mentioned to you guys. When you come out of there, the diving section, if the wind is to the right, which it was, you want to go right, because it's faster. But if the wind is neutral, or to the left, then you want to go to the left. Like, if the wind is right, then you end up there. But if the wind is left, it's pretty much equidistant to go here and grab this warp. And once in the warp zone, we're heading to the left. So they're almost exactly the same distance. So it really just, if the wind is right, then you go right. But if it's neutral, then it's a little faster to go left, because then you're already a little further left in the warp zone. I think maybe if the wind is very, very, very slightly right, it might still be faster to go left, but there's no great way of telling that. So if you just notice the wind is going right, go right, and if you're not sure, go left. It's not a huge deal, but anyways. So now we warp to jungle, and I'm really hurt, so I'm going to try and be careful of these monkeys. But at some point, something we did triggered this shortcut mushroom to grow. There's a lot of shortcut mushrooms that get triggered kind of randomly. They're not always triggered by what you'd expect. With high jump boots, you can jump straight to the... Oh my goodness. Please no. Piranha almost... I guess it wouldn't have killed me. Maybe I can get extra coins here. I don't know. Anyways, so, what triggers the shortcut mushrooms isn't always what you'd think. And that... that bat was already startled. I don't know why. That's interesting. Just damage boost through those. Whatever. Again, I'm not jumping here because I think because the current's going so fast, it actually slows me down. And it certainly doesn't speed me up very much. I do jump here. I don't bother with mashing the cannon that hard, because again, I have to shift my grip for it, and it's a very short distance, so... Cannons are really... it's 1 pixel every time you fire it. It's the most negligible thing possible. Oh, if you jump on those crabs, you keep your speed from the current, and get a little boost. Oops, I missed. Shoot. Man. This part I need to practice on, because I tend to miss this stuff, and now I'm kind of hurt, actually, so I'm gonna be careful. A little bit. I guess I don't really need to be careful. It's the end of it. Anyway, so there's a long puzzle to the right here, but I don't have time for that. So I'm just going to save there to get health back. And, I'll explain this. So you'll notice when my collision is based on where my body is in the boat. But you'll notice when I turn left and right, I'm sort of swapping where I am. Now, usually against a wall, that just means it shoves you away. But if you turn and jump at the exact same time, you will lodge yourself inside the wall, and then it'll spit you out on the left side. And that's actually in the pirate ship mini-boss earlier. If you don't get the cutscene skip, that's how you skip that. You can get yourself right next to them, and then sort of lodge yourself in them, or jump up and then hit right as you hit them, and jump again, and you can, like, wall jump off the ship. It's the backup strat for that, if you don't lodge yourself inside them during the cutscene. Okay, I have something which might be a delusion, but I think the bird goes faster if you turn left and right as you flap, because I think he gets, like, double flap. It certainly doesn't slow you down, so whatever. If someone wants to bother figuring that out, go ahead. But, like, that seemed really fast, suddenly. But sometimes if you're flapping normally, you just go really fast, suddenly, so... I really don't know. I should probably have done the research there, but... I know it doesn't slow me down, and so I'm gonna do it anyway. Oh, I almost screwed that up. I almost felled Flappy Bird. test your Flappy Bird iOS skills. I think you're kind of expected to fly all the way back, but I'm gonna do what I'm assuming pretty much everybody did while playing casually and just run into these spikes instead, because it's way faster. Because he just comes back to you in a straight line. Bit of dead air. There's not really tricks. Oh, I get. I'm not going to jump on the boat here, even though it would technically go fast because those vines are there, and I just grab onto the vines instead. I don't think you can avoid grabbing them, actually. Maybe you can if you jump at just the right time. But whatever. Jumping saves more in a boat. Saves more time than the cannonballs do. But neither of them are save so much time that it's worth. Risking something for. So the first half of this room I'm pretty much gonna do as intended. You don't have to kill either of those, but you can do it without losing time, so I often do. So you shoot two cannonballs, bombs to open up this area, and then shoot a third that sits there. You're gonna shove that block in place. And then we're gonna blow up this wall here. It's fast if you throw it so that it lands on the enemy, because then it'll explode immediately. Sometimes the enemy's on the far left, though, and you can't, and then you just have to wait. You do have to be careful. If you throw it on the way down, it can get caught on the wall, and on, like, one of the ledges, and, then it'll get stuck on the wall, and you have to pick it up and throw it real quick before it explodes, or you have to go get another bomb. Anyways, you may have noticed I'm not doing this right anymore. You have to push this block to a pretty specific point. There's a bit of shadow off the wall on the left, so I use it so that if there's either no pixel or one pixel of light-colored block, then it's in the right position. Don't push it all the way against the wall, or you have to reset the whole room. But basically push it so that it's against... You have to push this block so that it's against the wall, but enough that you can fit in. And then you hold down and crouch, and you'll just zip through. Oh, and right. If you hold left, you won't zip through. You have to hold down, crouch, and right. Forgot to do that. Okay, so I'm going to do another cutscene skip here, and the trigger for it, it's kind of hard to explain, but I'll try and put my foot right on it without triggering it. Do a little shimmy here. So you'll see there's like a dark... The way I use it, it's like the third set of breakable blocks right before it. There's this tile pattern of like dark and light dirt, and there's like a dark piece of dirt right there. And right, like my character's left foot is touching, just barely touching a slightly darker patch of grass, or dirt. It's really hard to see. I guess I don't have a better way of differentiating it, but right there is where the cutscene trigger is, so... And you know you get it because you'll hear the music has faded out. And once you know you get it, you want to mash that as soon as possible, because you have to wait for this dude to walk over. He's solid right now. And he won't walk over till you finish your bird's dialogue. Once they start talking, though, this thing turns not solid, and also your animation freezes, so you're... In this case, you look kind of like you're running. Oh, I should have been mashing through dialogue this whole time. But yeah, this lets you get a free hit on them. Which is really handy, and also means they're more to the left for the next 2 hits, which means you hit them a little faster. I don't really have any strategy for the second and third hits, though. You kind of just have to play it out. I've tried skipping through. I don't see a way to do it. You just kind of have to wait for them to do this attack, which they do with pretty good regularity. Oh, I actually got hit. Wait. And then they'll toss a bomb, and then yeah, you pretty much just have to fight them as intended. I've yet to discover a way to get past them otherwise. I've tried several things, and I can't dialogue skip through them, I can't jump over them at any point. You pretty much have to wait for them to toss a bomb. Whoa, I keep doing it, am I? I suppose one thing is, for the third hit, you want to make sure, you want to try and hit them with your cannon aiming as far right as possible so that you hit them sooner. It's pretty minor though, and I don't turn it too far right because I have a tendency of missing, and if you miss, that's real bad, of course, so... Oh, this is awkward. Ugh, I'm not even sure I could make it through that. I probably could have if I jumped at the right time. He doesn't usually blow up the two blocks. That's kind of bad luck. And then he was standing right on it, so it was a tricky jump. I think he can stand... If he blows up both blocks, he can stand in a way that it's impossible for you to get past. If he's standing, like, right on them. Just a correct manner. Whoa. I hit you. Whoa, really? Dang. Brutal. But yeah, he doesn't block you very often. Wow, dynamite, too. Nice throw. This guy's on fire today. He could kill me with these rocks, actually. And I can't dodge them or anything. Oh, he stopped throwing them. Oh shoot, I missed! Got him, okay. So, I lost a bit of time there because I went further to the right, but whatever. At least I didn't have to do another cycle. So that was kind of a bad fight, but I don't... Other than missing the third cannonball, I don't really feel like there's much I could have done about it. I guess not missing that one jump would have been nice. And now we go into the auto-scroller. Because it's not a real speed one without one. So this, the way this is supposed to work is there's an auto-scroller and then a long section with like a mech, which is really cool, and then you just finish off the last bit of the auto-scroller. But that's not how this is going to play out. But you'll see when I get to it. Also, every once in a while I actually die on this auto-scroll, and it's super embarrassing. But I think I finally stopped doing that. Not much to talk about till I get to the end of the auto-scroller, though. It's good music. You can stand here, it won't, like, knock you off. It looks like it will. But that would kind of break the auto-scroller. Oh, right here is the entire backstory to the whole game. I hope you paid attention. I saw another slight jump. I hope my hard drive's not gonna fail in the middle of this. This part of the scroll, I think it's random where they shoot the cannonballs. I tend to get hit a few times, but it doesn't really matter that much. I'm gonna take a save no matter what coming up, so as long as I don't die to cannons. Okay, so this is a trick. If you jump right before those blocks hit and you just hold right, they'll sort of fall into you and then you're inside of them and then it gets really messy. If as long as you just keep holding right, you'll fall through, and you'll land on the tracks, which means the game triggers that you're still, you're still in the cart, because you're on the tracks, so you must be in the cart. So, after these slimes, there's a bit where I need full health or I cannot do a skip, so I cannot get afford to get hit by these slimes, which is made really hard by the fact that by the time I finish that cart ride, the slimes are all on the left side of the platforms, and... Like, even this platform, which really is easy to get to, it's like a pain in the butt to get over him while he's shooting and stuff. I did it, but whatever. But anyways, the final slime in particular can be a real pain and can actually get into a position where he's shooting balls you can't dodge. I'm actually did okay on this. But anyways, I just saved. I hope I just saved. It'd be funny if I forgot. I'm pretty sure. Yeah, okay. And actually... So, sorry, I just... By saving, and then reloading, I'm resetting the slime's positions, and they move pretty slowly, so I should be able to get across before they all get to the- Oh my god, I jumped in that. I'm sorry. I might have to do this a few times. I'm still- This is one of, like, two or three areas where I'm still very bad. Because I can't take a single hit, so... there is a handy thing where if you whack us while it's flashing red, they don't hurt you, So it's real handy. Oh, I missed my jump, and now I have to dodge this. Ugly. This jump is the really hard one if the slime's on the left. And he almost... Oh, I'm sorry. I might edit this. Because it's really embarrassing. If I fail one more time, I'm probably just gonna edit it. But yeah, that last part, where you have a pretty narrow jump that you can do. You have to do a very specific jump. And he's likely firing his little tiny balls, and he's standing right on the edge. And you kind of have to grab onto the edge and jump up and swing at him, and then jump up again. It's just more consistent to do the save and then reload. If you don't want to do that, more power to you, but I think it's faster to just do that for consistency's sake. Anyways, this is the reason why I needed full health. Well, you're supposed to spin this wheel around like 3 times and then get some water and then do some back and forth puzzle, but each one of these flames coming up only does 2 damage. So as long as you don't get hit by one of the projectiles, which I just stopped so that I didn't, you can just damage boost past them. And you'll notice I'm jumping before I get to them, because they can fire the projectile at any time, so I'm just, in case they fire at the last second, I'm jumping so I don't get hit by it. Although if you get hit by it really close to the slime, you're probably okay. To the fire, you're probably okay. Anyway, so now we're in the stealth section. And this is why I bought the blue hat earlier. If you didn't know, these guys think anyone wearing blue is part of the security, is part of the janitorial team, and they won't apprehend them. So instead of having to wait for a long time for these robots to turn back and forth so I can move safely through, I can just walk straight through this section. So it's definitely worth the time it takes to get the coins. Because this section would take... there are parts where you just have to wait for a long time, so... Oh yeah, and I need to... Oh no, I think I'm gonna get the coins later. I'm gonna go out of my way for coins in the desert. I think I can find an extra chest there or something. I hope I remember where they are. That one glitch with the treasure chest really throws us off a bit. Oh well. Anyways, so... Yeah, so those flame guys are actually... Oops, I fell. The flame part of skipping the flames can be really tricky. They didn't fire many projectiles that time, but they can fire whenever and as often as they want, so you do have to be really careful with them. Because again, if you take one hit, you can't skip past any more flames, so... And the flames will sometimes chase you for a very long time. Sometimes the security door into this area doesn't open fast enough, and I have to actually keep running and take the elevator back up to the city and come back down. Because there's a flame coming, and there's just too many of them. I can't get out of their way. Anyways. We're now going to do this, this bit. So I kind of don't want to take damage here, but if I take a damage from one of those, it's fine. If I do take a damage from them, then I'll... Ooh, whoa, never mind. I was going to say then I won't take a damage from one of these, but then I did by accident. I want to open both of those lockers. Two of these lockers have coins. Ordinarily at this point, I would have 50 coins, which is enough to buy the shark repellent. But since that one chest glitched out, I don't have coins. So I'll be going out of my way later, as I said. But, you kind of just want to avoid damage here, because it's tricky. It can be kind of dangerous. I'm still kind of figuring out how much damage I can afford to take in the first area. I think I can probably afford to boost my way through more lasers, but if I don't, I can boost my way through these lasers instead, which is pretty handy. So the basic premise of the next section is you have to activate this button with a laser, and there's this one, and then there's 2 progressively harder ones to get the laser and shoot it at the button. Now the thing about these lasers is when they move far enough off your screen, they stop moving. But once they're back on your screen, they keep moving, and they go through walls. So we're actually going to solve all 3 puzzles from up here. So for the first laser, you want to go here and aim down. You kind of want to aim between the 2. If you see beneath me, there's like 2 blocks that are connected. You kind of want to aim right down that line. You don't want to go too far to the left, because if you stand right here and fire, you'll actually activate the button above you. And then you'll fall down and then you can't do a skip. But if you just go right here and shoot, you can actually hear it activate, which is weird because usually you can't hear it activate from this height. Usually you have to go down for that to work, so it's kind of weird that you heard it activate already. Anyway, so you stand here, shoot one laser on that, because you have to go here and stand between these two rivets and aim downward. And you won't hear anything yet if you listen. Boom. You've activated that one, and probably skipped what I found to be the hardest part of the game. Normally. And this is probably my favorite cutscene skip, and it's also the very first one I discovered. It's right on this, the marker for it is this pipe in the background. The right side of the pipe is the line right where the cutscene starts. So I'll just slide past. Oops. Wait, was my? No. Man, I'm not getting it. Sorry. It's a little bit past the pipe, and I'm totally failing. This is weird. There we go. Okay. Sorry about that. I usually fail that. So what I like to do is turn left here, because then I flip my hat backwards. You don't have to turn left, but I think it's really cool that you get to flip your hat backwards and moonwalk your way out of a boss fight, so that's how I do it. And now we're hearing the pirate theme and the song for this room playing at the same time, and that'll happen for a little bit. Don't worry, it won't be too long. Oh, I missed it. You can one cycle get up there, but that's not how you do it, obviously. But you can get up there on the first cycle. I've done it a few times, but I'm not exactly sure. You think you just have to land on the cog. Whoa, that wrench. Be careful about taking damage here, because you really don't want to. I'm usually pretty cautious about that one laser. Okay, so we're skipping this entire room. Just stand on one of these cogs, wait for it to push you in, and then crouch and hold left, and you'll go right in here. And then you can activate this. And you can skip this entire room. And I play on a controller, like I said before, which is actually not ideal for these mini-games, because it's really easy to hit, like, up on a keyboard over and over. It's kind of a pain to hit up on a joystick repeatedly, and you can't hold with a joystick. And I'm not the best at these mini-games, so I'll freely admit that I'm probably losing some time by being bad at these mini-games. Oh, and also, thankfully for us, the pirate theme is supposed to trigger to play here again, and then it's triggered to turn off here, so we don't have to listen to the pirate theme overlaid on top of other songs for the entire rest of the game. Which, I'm pretty sure if the pirate theme didn't trigger here, we would have to listen to it for the rest of the game, over every other song. Which would probably drive me crazy. So, it's really fortunate that it turns off there, because I don't think it would otherwise. And I'm gonna do another bird trick here. This time, the line that I want to slide past is the line on the door itself, where the two door halves meet. That's a pretty easy one. And then you just walk over here, and he talks, and now... So the basic setup for this boss fight is there's supposed to be, you know, he randomly chooses one of the three computers you're supposed to go to that hasn't been picked yet. But we eliminate... We can't get to either of the top ones by doing this skip, but we can get to the lower left one for free. And play this Frogger game, and, I can get ahead of that one little Frogger part, but I didn't go fast enough. This is the route I use, because I find it consistent and relatively fast. There might be a better one. I'm really bad at Frogger. I'm really bad at Frogger, so this is one that works for me. If someone finds a better route, I'll try and learn it. It's good enough, and I stick with it. Okay, and for this part of the fight, the key to this, and I don't have this properly done yet, I once did, and then I kind of forgot how to do it right, but the basic premise is you want to make it so that you hit this guy, and he's disabled near the pipe, right when the bird comes out, so that the bird drops the cog on him immediately. And I'm still kind of trying to figure out the best ways to do that. And I think the 100% one has a really good route for this fight, and oops, I should have hit him there, and I So yeah, that was really bad. I flubbed my cue because I was talking, I think. But yeah, it needs work, but basically, you generally want to hit him a couple times, like three times. Okay, so here he can pick one of two computers he wants us to go to. And he's picked the top left, which is really good for us, because it makes it really easy to get to the top right. If he picks top right, you have to go, like, around and to the right, and it's really lame. So you have a 50-50 chance of getting a good pattern, which is... this is the good pattern. Which is, he picked top left, but these walls are solid, he can really hurt you. So you just jump up here, and you take one damage, and beat this phase, like, immediately. So that's the good pattern. With the bad pattern, I can't really show it to you, but basically it's, you just have to damage boost yourself more, and you have to go around more, and it takes a lot longer. But either way, you're going to the top right computer first, no matter what. It's faster both ways. No matter which pattern he chooses, which one of the computers he wants you to go to, it's faster to choose the right one, and then the left one. That's just the way it works out. Where is it? No, it is. Actually, if he chooses the left one, it doesn't matter, because you'll be doing the attendant both ways. So I guess you could do left and then right if he chooses that. The things that influence how long this takes are exactly where, not just when you hit him, but also like how low he is when you hit him. If you hit him when he's lower, it takes longer. So I think when I start on the right, that was good. But it wasn't terrible. I'm just gonna damage boost my way to the top left. Oops, that's one's not solid, now he's gonna die. And I play Pac-Man really cautious because I don't want to lose it. And it's... wow! Blocking me. And again, I'm shifting my grip here a lot so that I can hit left or up or down quickly. But I'm still pretty bad at it. Pac-Man... the Pac-Man minigame, like the Farger minigame, I'm really admitting I'm not. I'm just gonna hang out there. Thank you. They kind of block me. They tend to get stuck in the top left. They're random, but it seems like they get stuck in the top left a lot. At least to me. Anyways. Oops! Well, okay. I guess I'm making this up as I go. Which is kind of what I'm doing anyway. So I think what I want to do is wait till he comes back around to the center and then hit him once more, and then that'll be good. But I'm not... like I said, I'm not really sure when I'm supposed to hit him here. It's something I need to figure out. Oh, I don't think the bird's gonna appear in time. Nope, shoot. Yeah, see, and now I have to waste time while he goes up again and the bird's waiting to draw. But it wasn't that bad. I need to tighten that bit up a bit. I don't really... that's the part of the boss fight I haven't routed terribly well. Oops, I jumped past it. Okay. So, we're gonna heal in the pawn shop just because we want full health. This is something I would do in the ordinary run because it saves time. I'm not just doing it because I'm being safe, for explanation's sake. We're gonna take damage to save time up ahead. So, one thing we're doing here, oops, hold on, sorry. Okay, back, sorry. One thing we're doing here, instead of walking, we could walk across this jungle and warp zone, but it's actually a little faster to warp here and then rewarp. That saves like 4 or 5 seconds, I think. Maybe not that much. And we go here and we go to, what, 939? We go to where the piranhas are gathered, basically. And you want to leave this area with 3 health. Ideally, because that keeps you safe. It's the safest thing to do, while still being pretty fast. But I'll probably screw it up, because I screw this area up a lot. So I'm gonna... you have to choose where you want to damage boost past these tentacles, and I'm pretty sure it's fastest to do it on the way down. Oops, I took a damage... ah, it's fine. That's fine. I took damage from the spikes instead of the tentacles. No big deal. And yeah, if you damage boost on the way down, you should have just enough time. Oops. So yeah, I didn't want to take damage from the spike. I cut it real close. So, ordinarily you'd have just enough time to get past the two horizontal tentacles without taking damage, and then you could damage boost past both the vertical tentacles on your way out, but I took a damage from spike on my way up, so I didn't. So I have 3 health for a couple reasons. One is, on the off chance I get hit by this guy, I still have 1 health, because he takes 2. I want to have at least more than 1 health, because these piranhas can randomly attack me. It's not terribly likely, because they tend to wait a moment, but they totally can. And I used to go down to 1 health down there, because it was a little faster, and then every once in a while a piranha would just kill me, and I was like, why don't I go down to 1 health? So I don't do that anymore. Anyway, so you go back to the jungle and grab the warp, and now you warp to the lava land here. And this is why I wanted at least 3 health. Oh, wind's really against me. I might die here, actually. Basically, right here, you have to go past the sharks, and if the wind's not with you strongly, there's a very good chance you'll take 1 hit from sharks, and they do 2 damage. Oh, I'm actually doing alright. Okay, I got a little lucky. If the wind is against you, it's pretty likely you'll take a hit from them, and they do 2 damage, so if you take a hit from them and you don't have at least 3 health, you die. So that's why I like to leave that last dive area with 3 health. But that time I didn't take a hit, which I was surprised. The wind's against me, but only slightly, so I guess I got a little lucky. I didn't have to dodge that guy. Oh well, whatever. Oh right, I totally forgot. So ordinarily I would have 50 coins here, but like I keep pointing out, I got screwed by that one chest that didn't give me any coins. So I'm going out of my way here to get more coins. This is not part of the run, I'm just... Oh wait, I should probably get those too. I'm just getting these because I don't know what else to do, I guess. I think there's enough coins down here that I'll be alright. Ordinarily, I would have just gone in like I did and talked to the salesman. Oh, you're just going to give me one? Alright. There we go. Okay, so pretend I didn't go on that extra trip. Because it's really weird that that chest didn't give me coins. Maybe because I was standing on the spawn point for them? I'm not sure. Anyways, so you need shark repellent. Oops. You need shark repellent. And it's 5 lines of dialogue, not 6. Which is why I skipped it. So yeah, you need shark repellent, because you can't get past those sharks otherwise. If you were doing an 100% run, and in fact the 100% run that exists, he does this. If you get all the health, you can tank the sharks and just go down and back up, and you have enough health to deal it. But obviously, I only have 7 health, and those sharks swarm you, so there's no way that I can get down there without the repellent. I will die. They just kind of swarm all over you, and there's no real dodging or anything. Unless someone knows something I don't. But it doesn't seem possible to me. So that's why I need the 50 coins. And usually I don't have to go out of my way for them like that. And then you go right over here, so you can grab the warp. Because the desert warp is really, really far to the left. Now I've just got 1 more treasure to get. So you go to the tree island, as I call it. I'm using my own names for all these islands. Like Lava Land is the one with the lava, Tree is the one with the big tree. They've all got real names, and I don't know them, and I guess I should feel a little ashamed of that. Anyway, so you go here, you go to 242, and then you dive down. And this one's pretty much totally safe. You would have to try to die here. You actually can take damage here. There's spikes, which are in places that are very hard to hit. I mean, this is supposed to be the easy dive treasure. It's kind of supposed to be your first one. But also, that anglerfish actually can hurt you. You have to touch the front of his mouth, is his hitbox. And he's usually just in the wall. But I did assume that he just... Because you can go through his body, I assumed that he never did damage. And one time I only had 2 health here, and I was just ascending, and I just thought he was, like, decorative. And I went right through his mouth, and I took 2 damage and died. So, you can die there. Oh, and I got Moonwalk, which I should have mentioned. If you... Oh no, I don't have it anymore. I lost it. If you wiggle back and forth just right while you're in a diving section, you can lock your direction looking a specific way, which I do sometimes because you've got some free time. I'll try and do it on my way up. I don't think I'm gonna get it. That's unfortunate. I'm not really sure what the timing is because it's not useful at all. But you can just always be looking left or always be looking right, basically. So we've got all the treasures, so now we just have to do the final dungeon and the final boss. So once again, you just warp here. And Baggins has a big exclamation point above his head, but you do not need to talk to him. That is not the case. It's a lie. You can just skip him. Which is probably really confusing for him. So I'm pretty specific about what I want to take damage here. I could damage boost on that saw, but it saves very little time, so it's not worth it. Oh, these beetles are kind of obnoxious. They're not terrible. Okay. Those beetles are very short. The second set of beetles is under a very short wall, so I generally play pretty cautious. Especially when they're like this. Okay. I probably could have done that a little faster, but whatever. Ideally, both sets of beetles are very close to the right side, and you can just flame them all and kill them. But sometimes they're very far on the left, and they're not on and if they're not on top of each other, it can be hard to jump over, and sometimes you can even get stuck between them getting bounced back and forth and take a lot of damage you don't want to. So, yeah, I took that a little carefuler. A little too carefully? A little carefuler? Really? Okay. Getting a little tired here, I guess. So I took it a little more careful than I should have, but... Ooh. Oh, really? I should have taken that a little more carefully. Oh well. I could probably afford to damage boost past that a little bit more than I do anyway. Whatever. Oh, don't be going in there, thank you. If he goes in the middle there, you have to kill him or get him out. Anyways, I think I've still got enough health to do this. You know what, I'm not sure I do. No, because I took that extra spike damage. Shoot. Well, whatever. I'll pretend. So I do this, and I do this, and I should have only taken 2 damage there, but I did it really clumsily. So I took 3, and now I can't do the rest. Okay, so I'm going to pretend like I didn't take 2 more damage than I wanted to. I wouldn't ordinarily, I just do the rest of the dungeon as intended, but since I'm demonstrating stuff, I'm going to go up and heal. Because I did that real clumsy, and I took an extra damage while crawling down, and I took an extra damage from the spikes that you'd normally go over with a barrel. So... So I should have gone into that final area with, like... What? 5 health? And I went in with 3? Is that right? I don't know. I should have gone in with more. In a real run, it's just like, if you take extra damage, you just roll with it and keep going, of course. But ideally, you want to save... Wait. Got one more. Ideally, you want to save as much as your health as you can for this section, because you can skip the entire puzzle. This part, obviously you don't need to, but here, if you have enough health, you can skip across the whole section. If you don't have enough health to do that, if you've only got, like, 2 health... Then you can do this. And then you just do that. And don't worry about this fire guy. He doesn't shoot. Well, that was actually the earliest he could possibly shoot at you. If you fall down and hold right, like, he's not on screen before you fall down, and he has a brief period of time where he won't fire. So you're totally safe. He will never hit you if you just hold right. That was the closest he can come to hitting you, I think. And don't worry about these things either. The spikes can hurt you, but the saw blades do not have hitboxes. That's just an oversight. I don't think anybody noticed, because by the time you're at this point in the game, they're really easy to dodge, so I think everybody was just dodging them anyway, but they don't do damage. So even if you only have... You can... Basically what I'm saying is the swinging platform, you can boost yourself down to 1 damage there, and it doesn't matter because the fire thing won't hurt you, and you really shouldn't get hurt on the saw blade. Anybody who hasn't played the game and cares about spoilers should probably stop watching now, I guess. I told you to play the game, though, so whatever. Because I'm at the final part, and if you stop watching now, you won't miss much, because there's no major glitches past this. There's no glitches at all past this point. I'll freely admit. Other than the glitch you're hearing right now, where that swing sound is happening repeatedly, that's me doing that. Otherwise, there's no glitches for the final boss, which is the only thing that's left. Yeah, unfortunately, there's not much to say past this point. I can't skip past this barrier. I've tried. It seems to shove you out to the right. It looks identical to the barrier in the ghost, in, like, the zombie skeleton tomb temple, dungeon place. It looks identical to that, but you can't seem to skip past it. Although force field always shoves you out to the right, and this looks like the same force field, so maybe it also always shoves you out to the right. But also, this game has a lot of things where two items that are theoretically the same thing work differently in different rooms and have different glitches attached to them, so it might just work totally differently as well. I really have no idea, but I can't seem to skip past this barrier, so I have to watch this cutscene. Which is unfortunate, because I'd like to skip it, because then people won't see spoilers. Anyway, if you really care, I guess spoilers are over. I mean, there's still some spoilers, but this one's a bit less of a shocker. Whatever. You shouldn't really be caring about spoilers in a speedrun. I'm just talking about it to fill time, because I don't have much to talk about here. There's a little bit of optimization you do on the final boss. You can't skip him, you can't skip a phase or anything, but there's a tiny bit of optimization. And you also actually have to pay attention, because with 7 health, he can kill you pretty quick if you screw up. And sometimes, I'm pretty sure there are situations to put you in that are basically undodgeable, or very nearly. So you have to be careful about that, too. Because sometimes you will damage boost to get a hit in on him. And if that happens, if it so happens that you damage boost repeatedly, well, I guess I'll talk about it as I get to it. So the basic way that this fight works is, you wait for Wakanda the Swan to show up, and then she crashes the game. Okay, so my game just crashed. I'm, going to take a very quick break, and I'm going to cut. I'm actually going to cut here. And, I will show you the final boss. When I come back. Just a quick cut. Away. Okay, and I'm back. Yeah, this game, in a normal run, like I said, doesn't usually crash, but, well, actually, I think I said that after the cut. But basically, in a normal run, this game doesn't usually crash, but the longer it runs for without saving and the more stuff you do, it seems like there's an increased chance of crashing. That might just be my computer, though, which is pretty funky right now. But, yeah, basically, in the length of a normal speedrun, I don't think you're likely to crash. But if you're taking a long time and exploring like I am and explaining things, then, yeah, you are kind of likely to. Anyways, the basic flow of this is there are 4 stages. Each stage, he gets a new attack. And you basically have to wait for Wakanda, the Swan, to show up. And then she gives you an energy ball. She shoots it at you, wherever you are on screen. But it's faster to, it's faster to stand right on her with your magic bottle out and grab it immediately than it is to have her shoot it at you, because you move faster than the energy ball does. And also, you don't have to, like, worry about dodging things. So, it's faster to just stand right where she's spawning it. And sometimes that means taking a hit to get to him. And you basically want to move to the right as much as possible. Right, then he was horizontal with me, so it didn't matter, but if he was at the bottom of the screen, I would want to be moving right as much as possible so I'm close to this portal, while I was moving down as well to hit him. And the other thing you have to worry about is shooting your energy ball into one of his attacks. I'm actually getting pretty good luck right now. A lot of the time, he sort of gets in a pattern where he's shooting his attacks right when you're trying to hit him, and your attacks will clash with his attacks and cancel each other out, so you want to not have your energy ball hit into one of his attacks. So you'll usually just run through it. Or wait for it to go away, depending. See, I'm going to take a hit right here so I can grab the energy ball quick. And sometimes when he's lifting an object up above, and it's on top of him, you have to wait for it to pass or they'll collide. But yeah, that's pretty much it. This is actually really good luck so far. A lot of times he'll make you do a damage boost to hit him all four times, and obviously that'll kill you. And then you can't afford to take an extra hit, and you have to be really careful. But this time he's being really nice. He's only made me take a damage boost once, and this is already the last phase. So, like, at this point I can be really reckless when I get the energy ball, because it doesn't matter. Unless I manage to take, like, two hits in the next 7 seconds. Oh, and the safest place to hang out is above or below him until he uses this eyeball attack. And then it's not the safest place, of course. And this attack, you have plenty of time to move to the side, and then you just move diagonally and you'll always dodge it. Pretty simple. If you get unlucky, he can really actually be kind of difficult to kill still, but whatever. There we go. And I call end time on the foot. So I call start time, I'm not sure if I said that, I call start time when I select a file, and I call end time on the foot. I think the guy who did 100% called end time when you went in the final portal there, and I guess that's technically correct because that's the last input, and maybe if I submit this to some official site I'll use that time, but I think for my own timing I prefer to use the foot, so I call end time. I think it should be pretty obvious why I prefer that timing. So yeah, that's Treasure Adventure Game. And that's how you speedrun it. And thank you for watching and listening to my somewhat rambling explanations and putting up with my really lame death and my crash. Yeah, that's pretty much it. If you have any questions, feel free to ask me. I'll respond. I'm gonna put this up on YouTube, so just ask in the comments. If you think you have a better way to route this, that'd be really cool. I'd be interested in seeing it. I was pretty much... there was a guy who did the 100% run whose name I don't remember, and I probably should, because I stole a few of his... like, two of his tricks. I think. At least one of them. It really didn't seem like there was that much interest out there in running this game, so I just kind of did a route for myself for fun and dropped it for most of a year, and I just recently came back to it and I was like, I should actually get a good run of this, because I spent a lot of time exploring and routing and then never really put much time into running. and it seems like there's a few people out there who are really interested, so this is mostly for them and for a couple of my friends who were interested in what I was doing. So yeah. I hope this was interesting and informative and helpful and not too rambly, and I'll let the credits play out and I'll just mute myself because I think the song's pretty great. Thanks for watching.